Every season, there's going to be a few surprise players and teams. During the 2021 season, I'd say those teams are the Giants and Mariners, and some surprise players include Robbie Ray and Buster Posey. Sometimes, surprise players play so well that they find themselves in the MVP or Cy Young conversations. Back in 2012, one of the biggest surprises of the season was the emergence of Melky Cabrera, who turned himself into a serious MVP candidate by mid-season. Cabrera's new team, the San Francisco Giants, was his third team in three seasons after he was traded by the Yankees in 2009. It seemed that Cabrera found a new home with the playoff-bound Giants, but sometimes in life, things aren't as they seem. What do I mean by this? Well, to find that answer, we need to understand how Cabrera ended up with the Giants. Cabrera came into the league as an international free agent in 2001, and he was signed by the Yankees. He eventually made his debut in 2005, but he only stayed on the big league roster for six games. Cabrera started the 2006 season in AAA, but he ended up spending the majority of the season with the big league team. For a 21-year-old rookie who wasn't considered a top 100 prospect, Cabrera actually had a very solid season. He had a couple notable plays too, which included a walk-off home run against the Mariners and robbing a home run from Manny Ramirez. Cabrera spent the next few seasons with the Yankees. He never stood out offensively, but he was a good defender in center field. Some more notable highlights from Cabrera's Yankees tenure include a cycle against the White Sox in 2009, which was the Yankees' first cycle since 1995, and it's actually the last time a Yankees player has hit for the cycle. And another notable memory from Cabrera's tenure with the Yankees was actually not recorded, as it took place in a spring training game. In a game between the Yankees and Rays in 2008, a brawl broke out between the two teams. On a play at second base, Yankees hitter Shelly Duncan spiked Akinori Iwamura at second base, which caused a large gash in Iwamura's thigh. Apparently, this was in retaliation to a play that occurred in the prior week, where Rays hitter Elliot Johnson crashed into Yankees catcher Francisco Cervelli, which broke his wrist. Duncan was ejected, but then Rays hitter Johnny Gomes attacked Duncan, causing the brawl. Duncan, Gomes, and Cabrera were all suspended for their actions. But wait, why was Cabrera suspended? Well, the Rays claimed that Cabrera punched Evan Longoria in the back of the head, which of course is a big no-no in Tampa. The league office found evidence of the punch, which led to Cabrera's suspension. After the 2009 season, Cabrera was traded to the Braves in a five-player deal. However, he only spent 1 year in Atlanta, where he regressed slightly. He signed with the Royals for the 2011 season, and this ended up being a huge year for Cabrera. He set many career highs and ended the season with the second most WAR on the Royals, behind Alex Gordon. However, the Royals weren't exactly in a place to contend. But you know who was? The San Francisco Giants, the team who was less than 2 years removed from their 2010 championship. The Giants traded for Cabrera after the 2011 season. So how did Cabrera adjust to his new surroundings? Well, in his first month, he performed similarly to how he did with the Royals. But then the month of May came around, and Cabrera made history. Look at these stats. Despite hitting only three home runs, Cabrera had an OPS over 1100. How is this possible? Well, seven doubles and five triples certainly help, especially when the amount of triples you hit in 1 month matches the amount you hit in the entirety of the previous season. Speaking of hits, Cabrera hit 51 of them in the month of May, which tied a Giants team record for most hits in a month, a record held by Randy Wynn. Interestingly, Cabrera's performances led to the creation of a group of Giants fans showing up to games dressed as milkmen in support of the new team star. By June, Cabrera was seriously being considered as an MVP candidate, and he was a leading vote-getter for the 2012 All-Star Game. He was a starting outfielder for the National League All-Star Team, and he received a very warm welcome from the Kansas City crowd, since, you know, he played for them the year prior. He ended up winning the All-Star Game MVP award after going 2-for-3 with a single and a two-run home run. Speaking of stats, just look at Cabrera's first half stats. He was on top of the baseball world, and with the Giants in in the playoff hunt, Cabrera was about to be more valuable than ever. Unfortunately, in mid-August, everything changed in an instant. On August 15th, Cabrera was suspended for 50 games as he tested positive for high levels of testosterone. In response, Cabrera apologized and accepted his punishment. Interestingly, a few weeks prior to this news breaking, there were rumors that Cabrera tested positive for PED usage. Giants beat reporter Andrew Baggerly asked Cabrera about the rumors. Cabrera denied these rumors, and Baggerly even apologized in an article afterwards for even bringing up the rumors. Knowing at the time these were just unverified Twitter rumors, it's fair to say that asking a question like this only invalidated Cabrera's success as a player. Unfortunately, the rumors ended up being true. Obviously, this suspension didn't really affect the Giants' postseason chances, as they ended up winning the World Series. But this isn't where the story ends. A few days after the announcement of the suspension, it was reported that Cabrera tried to hide his PED usage in a very unconventional way. Cabrera created a fake website for a fictitious product to prove that he inadvertently took the banned substance that caused high amounts of testosterone to be found. If this alibi was true, it would have exonerated Cabrera of any wrongdoing, as he didn't intentionally take PEDs. The plan began in July when Cabrera and his representatives sought to explain why there was a spike in testosterone levels in Cabrera's most recent PED test. One of Cabrera's associates named Juan Nunez was alleged to have paid $10,000 for the fake website. Nunez was described as a paid associate, not an employee of the sports agency representing Cabrera. Nunez himself said that he was accepting responsibility for the creation of the website with Cabrera's agents, Seth and Sam Levinson, denying any knowledge of the scheme. And the agents were cleared of any wrongdoing in November 2012. Now, you may be wondering, why make this website in the first place? Well, after Cabrera and his management became aware of the rise in testosterone levels, they met with MLB league officials to dispute the evidence. The website was used in a presentation to league officials, basically to show that Cabrera had no knowledge the product he was buying would increase his testosterone levels. They tried to follow in the footsteps of Ryan Braun, who tested positive for elevated testosterone levels in October 2011, just after his MVP season. However, he appealed the 50-game suspension, and after several arbitration hearings, Braun won his case in February 2012. His argument wasn't that the test itself was faulty, but rather the proper protocols weren't followed in regards to Braun's urine sample. Multiple sources said that the sample wasn't sent for testing as soon as possible, as it was instead stored on a desk in the sample collector's home. Why did he bring the urine sample home in the first place? I don't have that answer, but whatever the reason was didn't matter because Braun won the appeal. This was the first time a player had ever successfully disputed a drug-related penalty. Of course, Braun ended up admitting to his PED usage in 2013, but Cabrera and his associates were certainly hopeful that this would end in their favor. However, when MLB officials looked further into the supposed website and product, they found that the product, a topical cream, didn't even exist. In an effort to create a trail of digital breadcrumbs, an ad for the non-existent cream was placed on an already existing website, insinuating that when Cabrera bought it, he was unaware it would raise his testosterone levels. Obviously, this plan failed, and Cabrera served his 50-game suspension, missing the rest of the 2012 season as a result. Also, Juan Nunez, the man who was responsible for orchestrating this whole thing, was sent to prison for 3 months for his role in the Biogenesis scandal that occurred in 2013. In fact, in 2018, Nunez sued the agency that represented Cabrera, alleging that he was encouraged by the agency to make under-the-table deals to players and families to attract players to the agency and help them obtain PEDs. He also said that the website was created at the direction of the agency, and Nunez took responsibility for cash payments. The lawsuit was settled out of court in 2020. I have to say, I didn't expect this story to head in this direction, so let's steer back to baseball. Cabrera played in 9 more seasons, with his final MLB appearance coming in 2019 with the Pirates. The closest he got to replicating his 2012 season was in 2014 with the Blue Jays, but he mainly spent the rest of his career as an average player with the occasional big game. So one thing I want to look at is how Cabrera's stats in 2012 compare to his previous seasons. Of course, there's a big jump in surface level stats, but I want to look a bit deeper. Cabrera experienced a big jump in BABIP in 2011, which led to his breakout year with the Royals and the trade to the Giants. However, his BABIP reached a career high in 2012, and coupled with a career high in isolated power, which presumably resulted from the PEDs, that's a recipe for an MVP caliber year. The question is, if he wasn't caught until after the 2012 season, would Cabrera have continued hitting at such a high level with 2 months of the season left to go? There's only so much BABIP luck someone can have until they regress to career norms. Then again, this was his second straight season of hitting at such a high level. Obviously, this didn't matter to the Giants, and there's no guarantee Cabrera would have won the MVP award considering his competition. But imagine a world where the MVPs in back-to-back years eventually admit to using PEDs. That would have been quite the headline. Now we're left with what-ifs, but what I can say is that it may be a long time before we see an attempted cover-up story as crazy as this. All I know is that I am ready for whatever happens next. I hope you guys enjoyed the video, leave a like if you did, and subscribe for more content just like this. Thanks for watching.